One dream team and 15 others, also with dreams, gathered in Canada for the 12th World Championships of Basketball. The teams were accompanied by loyal fans, some travelers, but many were drawn from Canada's multiculturally rich society. All were unified in their love of basketball and the desire to establish their nation amongst the international basketball elite. Never before had a World Championships featured such an array of stars. Stars who, like their lesser-known opponents, were drawn to represent their homelands.
Gotta say how I feel. I can't believe it, but I know that you're real. I know what I want, and baby, it's you. Standing on my feelings.
Incredibly, this was to be the first time the World Championships of Basketball were to be held in North America. But finally, international basketball was coming. Enter the world's state-of-the-art sports stadium, the Toronto Sky Dome. A new era in the history of the event was about to be launched. It was in the early 1970s that international basketball started to make waves. The USA began to send decent squads after decades of mediocre results, and European play was rapidly maturing. In the 1970 championships, the USA overcame a Soviet squad in the semifinals. But at these championships, it was the home team Yugoslavia who would ultimately triumph, sparking a basketball dynasty that won again in Manila in 1978. Finally, the U.S. Collegians won in Madrid in 1986. It had been 32 years since their last title. And in 1990, basketball witnessed the final act of the Yugoslavian dynasty as a youthful Tony Kukoc burst onto the world scene. One of international basketball's greatest pioneers, Drazen Petrovic, held the cup aloft and marked the end of an era and non-American dominance. In response to flagging results, the U.S. assembled the ultimate basketball team for the 1992 Olympics. The Dream Team concept was born out of the reality that three legends of the game were part of a genuine all-star team. And in Toronto, Dream Team Mark II was called on to represent the USA again. On an enormous world stage, these young players were given the unenviable task of meeting the original Dream Team standards. This is the official video of the 1994 World Championships. It chronicles Team USA's domination of the event. The fierce struggle of the other teams to destroy the Dream Team myth. It features the greatest players in the world and their dazzling skills in one of the most spectacular settings imaginable. The host cities of Toronto and nearby Hamilton were in readiness for the commencement of the 12th World Championships of Basketball. Fittingly, the opening day action was scheduled at Toronto's historic Maple Leaf Gardens, venue for the first ever NBA game in November 1946. Home Team Canada, bolstered by the return of Boston Celtic Rick Fox, prepared for their vital first game. The Canadians knew that playing a major championship in Canada was a two-edged sword. Pressure and public expectation would be delicately in balance with the value of hometown support. Their opponents, Angola, were dubbed the Black Nightmare by the Spanish media in Barcelona. The African champion's steady rise up the international rankings had come at the expense of any complacent opponent. This was Canada's danger game. Angola kept pace early, but it was the Canadians who had too much offensive firepower as Halas dunked on the break. Martin Keane's two memorable second-half slams were just the thing to set Canada off to a flying start. And Nyoko's three off the glass was the icing on the cake. Against a danger team of Angola's standing, this was a dream start, and the players knew it. South Korea and Australia opened the action at Cops Coliseum in Hamilton. An assist from Juk Jup Hyun to Gaze was an early highlight.
Right down the floor, Gaze, oh, lucky to get that back.
The only problem was they were on different teams.
He thought he was going to be able to go all the way.
This was a game that Australia was supposed to dominate, but the Koreans showing off an almost exclusively three-point offense hung tough. The Boomers from down under seemed to be rolling on to an opening win. Until some sizzling second-half shooting sparked a spirited Koreans comeback, leading to this dramatic final play.
Two-point game, 9 seconds to go, a three-point shot to win the game. There's the shot, and it doesn't go. Almost a tip-in, a scramble for the ball, no time left on the clock. That is the end of the ball game.
Cuba and the silver medal squad from Barcelona, Croatia, were matched up on day one. Tony Kukoc had just signed a $26 million six-year contract with the Chicago Bulls. And Dino Raja immediately showed why he had been voted the Celtics MVP award in his first NBA season. The youthful Cuba would have their hands full. Not only was there Kukoc and Raja, but rising star Komazic. Kukoc quickly showed why he is regarded as one of the sweetest passers in the game. The enthusiastic local Croatian fans were already booking their place in the final alongside Dream Team 2 as Croatia powered to a comfortable win. Greece versus Germany. And to the delight of a huge Greek contingent, their team is announced as the home side. These were European-style crowds that Canadian fans had probably never witnessed at a basketball game. Greece and Germany had played out a classic semi-final in the last year's European Championships in a similar atmosphere. Despite the heroics of Ianakis, the Germans squeezed past them and into the final against the Russians. A key cog in the German squad in Toronto was the enigmatic Henning Harnisch. Harnisch was the spark plug for the team which would provide the most famous moment in German hoops history.
2 points to Harnisch, and that is the value of support play. He's got 3 seconds, he's got one shot. Now, can he win the European title? Can he get it in, or will it go to extra time? This is a big, big shot. Yes! He's got it! 3, 2, 1, no! It's gone! And Germany are the European champions for 1993! And Christian Bell put that away, 71-50! And Germany are the European champions, and history is made!
Now, 12 months later, and Germany's Henning Harnisch, flowing locks and trademark bandana are gone. Harnisch was one player the Greeks would need to contain if they were to defeat their Euro rivals. Thanas Christodoulos had the fans and his teammates pumped early, and Harnisch opened up firing. This was a European derby of the highest quality. At times it felt and sounded like game night in Athens. A fast-paced first half was only halted by an exquisitely balanced Moulton. Then the Germans went to work inside, and Captain Hansi Gnad helped to carve out a narrow halftime lead. The Germans looked powerful in the second half, and when Fasoulis had his lip split in this clash, the vital game seemed to be slipping away from the Greeks. But Fasoulis' injury sparked a major turnaround. First veteran Ioannakis, and then the spark plug, Christodoulou. When the dust had settled, the Greeks had pulled off a remarkable 10-point victory. Goodwill Games gold medalists Puerto Rico were now after a world championship medal. Their first obstacle out of Africa, Egypt. Despite an early dunk from the 7-foot-1 Gouda, the Puerto Ricans had too much polish for the Egyptians. Ortiz's slam put the exclamation point on a solid Puerto Rican win. In Hamilton, it was China versus Brazil, and a new-look Brazil without the legendary scorer, Oscar. Chinese leaper Wee Dong Hu provided the early highlights with this impressive dunk. But this was a tight affair that would go down to the wire, neither team giving an inch.
With 3.2 seconds remaining, this game is tied up. Long outlet pass put up. It falls. Will it count? It does. It does. It counts. And with a dramatic basket at the buzzer, or will it count? A beautiful outlet pass to Kipoka. No time remaining. We are going to overtime. There was no time remaining.
After this near-death experience, the Chinese dominated the overtime for a vital 4-point win. And finally on day one, there was the team that everyone wanted to see, but not many wanted to play. Coach Don Nelson's greatest worry was expected to be PT, or playing time, with an array of stars and only 40 minutes between them. Shaq didn't take long to thrill the fans at Cops Coliseum.
That is our first Shaq attack of the evening.
Dream Team 2's campaign was off and rolling. Sean Kemp and Reggie Miller started spectacularly.
Miller with the jam. On a two-on-one, dishes for Reggie Miller.
Joe Dumars was on target, but so were the Spaniards. With nothing to lose, they were loose as a goose and having a ball. While Kemp was putting on a show, the scoreline was not as one-sided as most experts had predicted. USA provided all the highlights, but Spain won high praise, only succumbing by 15. One win into the tournament, and Croatian fans were out in force. Crowd idol Kukoc had them roaring early, and in tandem with Dino Raja, often. South Korea, after their courageous performance against Australia, were simply overpowered. The fans were planning party time for Puerto Rico when they lined up against Germany. Carter's wizard-like ball handling had the crowd roaring early. But the Germans had plans of their own, as Rodel spinned and dished to Upman for the jam. And Nurnberger's sweet pass for Harnisch proved that Henning was the European version of the human highlight film. Victory was sweet for the Germans, who still had firm plans and the form for a high finish in the top eight. Australia continued its winning ways at the expense of Cuba. But the big story was to break when the next day Cuban star Richard Matienzo would be the first of two players from the team to defect. Needless to say, Cuba's chances were well and truly slam dunked. Everyone loves a winner, and Torontonians turned out in numbers for Canada versus Argentina. Argentina had plenty of raw talent, but the home team had just the player to exploit their inexperience. Fox had Maple Leaf Garden sounding like a Stanley Cup playoff. The fans were pumping Fox and company, but for Argentinian coach Vecchio, the noise was too much to bear. The Argentinians tried hard to stem the flow, but Team Canada was rolling. For the home squad, it was 2-0, and it was smiles all around. China hardly had time to introduce themselves, and Sean Kemp was testing the strengths of Hamilton's backboards. While Shaq was quickly booked onto the highlight tape, the spectacular Weedong Hu also earned his spot with another impressive jam.
And Shaquille O'Neal controls over to KJ, up and under.
Kevin Johnson showed why he is regarded as one of the quickest men in the NBA. And then the show began as the full offensive arsenal was put on show.
Back over right side.
Yo.
Underneath. Dominique Wilkins. Yeah! Dominique, once again. Along the floor for the ball. Here's Dumars behind the back. Pass. Shot!
Finally, Kemp and O'Neal combined in a play that said it all. The Dream Team 2. Awesome. Angola had been handed two straight losses, and it was the same story for the young Argentinian team. Day three wasn't any kinder to Angola, but at last, the Argentinian fans had something to cheer about. Huge crowds were turning out to support Croatia. Australia would provide their first stern test, but Raja's elbows almost had their star player in trouble early.
Gee whiz, that's an offensive foul. It has to be, and they lift.
Cheeky little Aussie guard decided to take on the towering Stojan Vrankovic. But as the game progressed, one player gradually began to assert his influence. The Australians stayed within striking distance, but it was that man, Raja, who shifted the Croatians into overdrive. In the end, Australia had too few offensive avenues other than Andrew Gaze, and Croatia, too many. Dream Team 3, maybe? Canada was looking for three in a row, but then so were their opponents, the quiet achievers, Russia. Fans at Hamilton had turned out to see Rick Fox and Martin Keane. They had probably never heard of Bazarevich, Babkov, and Belov, but they were about to. There was a little spat early as Joey Vickery tangled with Vasily Karasev and ended up on the wrong end of the call. Feisty Nash responded at the other end, but whatever the Canadians did, the Russians seemed to do a little better. Keane was able to deny the wizardly Bazarevich on this occasion, but it was the unlikely-looking guard with a droopy mustache who had the final word. Day four dawns, and a vital clash between Puerto Rico and Greece, which will split up the logjam with Germany to decide which two teams would qualify for the top eight. Puerto Rico got off to a dazzling start. As for Sulis, with his war wounds, could only look on in dismay. After Carter found Ortiz for the dunk, it was up to the big Greek center to fire up the Toronto Hellenic Society. He did, but to no avail. By the time Ortiz and Carter combined to set up Vegas for the three, the game was in Puerto Rico's grasp. Puerto Rico went through to the top eight, but Greece would also still qualify at the expense of the luckless Germans. Basking in the glow of a good opening game against the USA and a solid win over Brazil, China was expected to be an easy mark for Spain, who seemed to be on their way back to the top eight of international basketball. In the early going, the Spanish were coasting, and the fans had already booked their tickets for the Sky Dome. But suddenly, things became a little more difficult, and the Chinese, who obviously hadn't read the Spanish script on this game, staged a dramatic comeback. As the second half wore on, Lolo Sainz became less comfortable. He decided to lay down the law. But the Chinese were on a roll and stormed back to take the lead. In the space of less than 10 minutes, Spain's tournament was teetering on the brink of disaster. It was a fantastic comeback victory for the Asian champions, earning them a top eight spot. And utter desolation for Spain. Fresh off the rest day they didn't need, Dream Team 2 matched up against Brazil in Hamilton. Don Nelson was cordial to his counterpart. However, Shaq didn't exactly reciprocate.
Oh, talk about power. There's a Shaq attack. One.
The Brazilians played gamely, but the overall offensive firepower of Dream Team 2 was dazzling. Shaq provided the big finish with one of the highlights of the tournament. This is the man who wears a Superman tattoo on his arm.
Oh my! Call him the entertainer!
Who was going to argue? The preliminary round was now completed, and eight teams had qualified for the quarterfinal phase. Australia, Canada, China, Croatia, Greece, Puerto Rico, Russia, and of course, USA. In the wake of Michael Jordan's retirement, Shaquille O'Neal was arguably the most famous basketball player on the planet. He was also the center of attention at the 1994 World Basketball Championships.
play, I consider myself Terminator-like.
Shaq never makes the bump on a dunk.
I'm just going out to dominate and to do one thing, and that's to win.
And Shaquille O'Neal is putting on a show.
I never heard about him with another girl. But
he's a big kid. I mean, he's 7 foot and 300 pounds, but he's a 22-year-old kid, and his mentality is that of a 16, 17-year-old kid. So he's, you know, to see a big guy like that getting up and dancing with all that energy and turning flips, it's funny to me because he's so big, but and you think of him as this big giant man, but mentally he's just he's a baby, and it's kind of funny to me to see him like that.
O'Neal's a great example of a guy that you want to be around all the time. He's a wonderful man. He's very sensitive. He's fun to be around off the court. And then on the court, you have this marvelous player who not only has the size and agility, but understands and uses his head and his brain. He understands what you're trying to do and where you're trying to go and how to get there.
That's because I don't believe in pressure. Pressure is when you don't know where your next meal is coming from. Therefore, I don't have any pressures. My job is a complex job, but I keep it very simple. Wake up, thank God for waking up, go to practice, practice hard. If it's a game day, play a game tonight, do the best I can, and just go about my life. And I just live for me, and I do things that I want to do. And I was raised very well, so I know that the things that I do, they'll be up to standard.
Shaquille with the dunk. Oh, Shaquille O'Neal makes his presence felt.
When you know that you're going to play Shaq tomorrow or after tomorrow, one thing you need to remember, you need to get your sleep and you need to eat and make sure that you have prepared yourself like mentally and physically, because the guy is really a master. He's strong and powerful. God created him different, really. You know, it's just he has a talent and he's young and he's just got full of body and full of muscle.
Shaquille O'Neal.
Just his size, the way he moves with his size, with his weight, and the power he generates. You just take him from the court, you probably would think he's a pretty rough guy, but probably on the court, off the court, he's probably totally different. But I never met him, so I can't really say anything.
If they were just to judge me by my play, they'd probably think I was arrogant, a little mean, a little cocky. I'm just going out to dominate and to do one thing, and that's to win.
The pass hits the sweetest note in basketball's tune. This is a tribute to those that think pass first, shoot second.
You are so beautiful. So beautiful. so beautiful.
Tipped off their quarterfinal phase of the competition against China, and the opening play set the tone for the rest of the game. The Chinese did penetrate and dish out for the three-pointer, but their absence of a consistent inside game and impact players like Raja and Kukoc meant they were no match for the Croatians. Canada and Greece matched up on day five. It was to be the pivotal game of the championships for both teams. It was a full house, as there were effectively two home teams. Canada sparked early and gave their supporters plenty to cheer about. The Shaq was on site and rooting for the home team, whichever one that was. It was a nip-and-tuck affair, but the presence of center Panayotis Fasoulis gave the Greeks the advantage. But Canada came storming home.
Great defense.
One effect without fouling. Harris for three. Corey Harris has hit the three. And it's a one-point game, 72-71. Just when it looked to be all over.
They run the 30-second clock. There'll still be 18 seconds left for Canada to score if they miss.
Bacatius has a block.
Canada!
Rick Fox comes back the other way. And they stop the clock. This is where those fouls in favour of Greece can help, because they stop the clock and only give up their fifth foul. They've got the ball inbound. It's in the hands of Nash.
Now's the time to foul.
Canada trails by one. Rick Fox has got the ball in the right hands. It's a great ball. Greece gives it up. Are they going to score for Fasoulis? That's the end of the ball game. Unbelievable. That's the all she wrote. The long three-pointer doesn't go. The big scream onto the court. Amazing scenes here at Toronto Maple Leaf Gardens. The celebrations go on in the Greek camp. The Greek supporters and the crowd go wild. Some have broken through the barriers and invaded the court as they hug Vanas Christodoulou.
When Puerto Rico met Russia at the Goodwill Games, the PR team won 105-85. The Puerto Ricans then went on to win gold. But this time, the bear was on the prowl as super athlete Kasurin got things going. The standard of play was high. The stakes were high. And in the end, it was the Russians whose superior teamwork shone through, and that man Bazarevich was there to finish things off again. Dream Team 2 had Australia in their sights as they opened up their quarterfinal phase. The performances of Australian scorer Andrew Gaze and big man Mark Bradke would be crucial if the Aussies were to be in any way competitive. Bradke got off to a big start, and the Boomers actually kicked out to an early 7-point lead.
Here's the steal. Nice steal by Gaze. Over to Heel, behind the back pass. Oh, ho, ho! That's Waltzy with Matilda. Andrew Gaze for two.
Price then decided it was time for reality to take hold. Heel launched one from the outer limits. And while this bomb went in, it may have lulled Australia into a run-and-gun duel with Dream Team 2. Mistake. Big mistake. A really big mistake. Australia went on to lose by 56 points. As day seven opened up, Canada was trying to rebound from two losses in a row, and Croatia was protecting a four-game winning streak. As usual, Kukoc was in the thick of things early.
Forcing Kukoc into a bad shot. Nash falls down, was fouled, but there's no call, and Kukoc says, thank you very much.
Rick Fox unsuccessfully tried to go over the top of Vrankovic. And the big man's defensive skills were again brought into play as he triggered yet another Croatian break. It always looked like Croatia's game. And when Dino Radja hit this shot from behind the backboard, it was hard to see the Canadians getting back into this one. Martin Keane gave it his best effort, though.
Oh, baby, Martin Keane! Get on up for the down stroke, baby. Martin Keane is in the house.
And when Kukoc shimmered through the Canadian defense, it was all over.
See ya, and I wouldn't want to be ya. Hearing a step slow right now. And there's the alley-oop by Dino Radja. And if he gives you a pass like that, you've got to tell him thanks. To a 22-point lead. And that will often result in more great passes like that. Have you seen enough? And that's the end of the ball game. Croatia finishing strongly and convincingly.
A feature of the 1994 World Basketball Championships was the crowd support generated by Greece and Croatia. On day seven, another sizable contingent of Greeks turned out to see their heroes up against China. All Greece had to do was beat China, and they had a guaranteed position in the semifinals while also achieving their highest international ranking ever. China was still in the game, but it was three triples in a row from Patavukas that buried China and allowed the blue and white celebrations to begin. Crunch. Australia's medal hopes came to an abrupt end when they ran into the ever-improving Russian squad. The Russians were simply too talented. Meanwhile, the U.S. was off to a quick start against Puerto Rico. A second half fracas between Shaq and Orlando Vega only seemed to fire the Americans up. And as the trash talk went on, Shaq got set for one of the plays of the tournament. That's all-time great Oscar Robertson. A 7'1" freight train named Shaquille O'Neal takes the ball from one end to the other. Bang! And from here on in, trash talk and showtime. And if the Puerto Ricans learned anything from this Dream Team 2, it was don't get them angry. Life in the bottom eight wasn't quite as glamorous as the top eight. Teams such as Spain and Germany, who were desperately unlucky not to qualify for the quarterfinals, only had pride and ninth place to play for.
Deutschland! Deutschland!
Back in Maple Leaf Gardens, Canada was trying to get back into the winner's call. Martin Keane set the tone with a nasty dunk. And then on a great pass from Nash, another nasty dunk.
Martin Keane with two dunks in the opening 2.5 minutes of this game. There's that save at the end line that goes into Martin Keane's hand. Return pass and Keane. Again, there's that alley-oop play to Keane.
Rick Fox's shot over the backboard had to be seen to be believed. And to cap it all off, Martin Keane left off where he began. The final day of the quarterfinal phase saw play move to the massive Sky Dome, which had been transformed from a baseball field to a basketball stadium in less than 24 hours. The atmosphere in tiered balconies was reminiscent of soccer terraces as the two best-supported teams in the championships finally met in a stadium that could hold all of their spectators. The first half was very tight, very competitive. ¶¶ But as we established the second half, Croatia started cruising ahead. For Croatia, the appointment with Dream Team 2 was now imminent, provided they survived their semifinal opponents, the Russians. Coach Don Nelson had little to worry about, and nor did his opposite number, Sergei Belov. This game would count for little, as both teams had already secured semifinal spots.
Get on up with a downstroke.
John Kemp threw that one three rows deep.
The Russians had nothing to lose and played relaxed basketball in the first half. The Russians even held the lead for a while. In fact, Don Nelson became the first coach of either Dream Team to ever call a timeout. While Basarevich nailed another three, the normal Dream Team 2 pattern was emerging as they began to physically overpower their opponents during the second half. Interested spectator Dikembe Mutombo of the Denver Nuggets. Another sluggish start replaced by a powerhouse second half by Dream Team 2. The block. It can inspire, intimidate, and ignite the offense. It is most of all physical.
In for Martinez, President, and that is our first Shaq attack of the evening.
Chris Paul is blocked by Gordon.
Inside, rejected by Coleman. Whistle out of bounds to the USA.
You say to me, I don't talk enough, but when I do, I'm a fool. These times I've spent, I've realized, and shoot through, and leave you. The things you say, your passports just give you away. The things you say, you're unbelievable.
Not in.
Oh!
Gee whiz, that's an offensive foul. It has to be, and they lift Mark Bradley on the floor. The booze go
unbelievable.
You're so unbelievable.
Short hit. Oh. Get on up for the down stroke.
The basketball court is a stage where all sorts can express themselves. The purists might cringe, but the fans and mascots are part of the total entertainment package. This is the lighter side of the 1994 World Championships of Basketball.
Deeply dippy about the fun we had. Deeply mad, mad for the fun we had. Oh, my love, I can't make head nor tail of passion. Oh, my love, let's set sail for seas of passion now. Deeply dippy about the way you walk, a contact sport, let the neighbors talk. Deeply dippy, I'm your Superman, I'll explain, you're my lowest plane. Oh, my love, can't make head nor tail of passion. Oh, my love, let's set sail for seas of passion now. Spanish eyes, Sierra smile, legs that go on for miles and miles. Oh, see those legs, man. Miles and miles. I said, oh, my love, can't make head nor tail of passion. Set sail for seas of passion. Oh, my love, I can't make head nor tail of passion. Oh, my love, so let's set sail for seas of passion now.
I'm taking a hike to the heat.
Greece versus USA. David versus Goliath. Even though it was 4 a.m. in Athens, there would be a huge television audience as the Greeks stepped in against Dream Team 2.
Dominique, he misses the easy one. Johnson with the tip. The United States relentless inside. Fasoulis finally bats it away. I counted about five attempts and five misses. Back the other way quickly. And a basket by Yorgos Tsiganis. A 6'7", 223-pound forward. Marley for three. Rebound to Greece. They have a one-point lead and a three-on-one break. And a nice bucket by Panayotis Yannikis. Able to capitalize. Wilkins on a 4-8 to the basket. Shaquille with the dunk. Potavoukas inside Terenzias. And it is knocked away and back the other way. And a great block that time by O'Neal. And Joe Dumars is off the mark. And Greece with a fast break basket by Yorgos Tsigalas. They almost lose it. Here's Kemp on the break, taking it home. Sean Kemp splits the key and sends it down the pike.
Price inside to Coleman for the dunk. Still up to Price, and quickly up to Dumars. Steps back for three, got it. Miller thought about it. Coleman goes inside. Shaquille O'Neal. But you know what? It was Derek Coleman, folks, that made that play possible and that basket possible. Marley with the rebound. He gets stripped. Morning falls down. And he's complaining that he was tripped. Tempo just a touch. Morning inside. Triple team. Stripped. Powers it up and is fouled. Alonzo Mourning. United States with a lot of patience there. And Alonzo Mourning with a very awkward looking shot. And you know what? When shots like that fall, you know it is destined to be your night. Greece has lost. Count it. What a fitting way to end. 97 to 58.
The second semifinal at Sky Dome pitted European rivals Russia and Croatia. Russia had defeated Croatia in the semifinal of the 93 European Championships in a major upset. Could Lightning strike twice?
Vladan Alanovic. Pass inside. Frankovic rejected. Mikhailov with a great block. Mikhail Mikhailov comes up with a steal, a two-on-one, and the Russians finish with feeling. Russia coming out with serious intentions to win this game. Here's Kasarev, he loses the ball. Kukoc with a breakaway dunk. You got it. Tony Kukoc, the premier player in Europe, or from Europe, presently of the Chicago Bulls, and a block by Frankovic.
Belov's squad played fast and loose in the first half, enjoying the fruits of their underdog status. But the Croatians weren't giving anything away either.
That's the type of play that can ignite a team. Frankovic hits the three-pointer, and Croatia has stolen away the momentum. He's been conspicuously silent so far. Likes to spin baseline. This time spins the other way. They were sitting on that other hand, and Raja comes over the top.
Raja's foul trouble would become crucial down the stretch for Croatia.
A one-handed
rebound. The game started to get physical as Croatia senses they're in for the fight of their life.
Making a bit of a space for himself. Down quickly. And he dishes off for the layup, and a nice layup at that by Vasily Karasov.
Belov's squad played fast and loose in the first half, enjoying the fruits of their underdog status.
22 after 20 minutes.
The second half was worthy of the semifinals of a world championship, with the Croatians taking the early initiative.
Vetchanikan makes the shot. The jump shot, and it's good for three. Komisek. We have a timeout on the floor with 8:07 remaining in the game, and Russia leading by five, and Komisek fueling this Croatian comeback. Tip up, no good. Raja battling. Azarevic comes up with the loose ball. Nice crossover. Oh, and one. Bazarevic, I'm telling you, the Croatian players are still looking for him. They've got to solve that inefficiency. And Babcock does. That way they take away the help defense. And a drive to the basket. Nice pass. And that's a foul on Dino Raja. And that is it for the night for him. He is gone. He can head to the showers. I would think they would go to Komisek, and they do. And he's rejected. And he misses an easy layup. Kukoc, he misses. This will not be the day for Croatia. They had three kicks at the can and they missed all three. Sergei Belhov finally cracking a smile. Babkov had a strong showing, he had 13. And the Russians are going to join the Americans in the gold medal game.
The fans' favorite play is the dunk. And here is a selection of the best from the 1994 World Championships. It was the gold medal day, but first, there was a bronze on offer. For Croatia, the bronze would be small compensation for their lost opportunity to meet the dream team. For Greece, it would mean a national public holiday would be declared.
For the opening tip-off.
I don't
almost hit the roof of Sky Dome. Greece shooting just 36.4% from the field. Croatia shooting 40% from the field on 4 of 10. Make that 5 of 11. Raja way outside. He calls for the clear out. Croatia clears out for Raja. Spins, a little bit of contact, but no foul call. Rebound back to Croatia. Second opportunity is hurting Greece, and it hurts them again. Nothing but sweet string music by Ivanovic. Right on Ivanovic. 1 for 3 from the field, 1 for 3 from the line, with a total of 3 points. Here's Sigalis. Nice move, but he misses. May have been a pass. Basulis gets a friendly roll, and it falls. They're just over 10 minutes here in the first half. Raja, another ISO play, and the tip in by Brankovic. For Greece, look at Sias number 5. He did a great job yesterday. Here's Raja, rejected inside by Basulis. Bakatsias doing what he did yesterday so well. Driving to the basket. Raja rejected by Basulis. Raja contending that the ball was on its downward flight and back the other way. Bakatsias. 34-26, 3:50 to play. Raja just rolling off the rim. The iron unkind for Dino Raja. Bakatsias outside, a three-pointer, good, splash. Panavoukas knocks it down for three. The pace of the game so far, I would think, would favor Greece. It's a slow-paced half-court game. Raja has it stolen inside by Basulis. A nice play by the tall Basulis. And Bakatsias makes a nice decision to dish it off. And they cash in on a fast break opportunity. Might have been just a little bit impatient, or they might have been playing for a 2-for-1 opportunity to get a quick shot up, and then they would get the last possession. Because right now, there's a difference on the shot clock and the game clock. So Greece will get another possession. That was good strategy by the coach, Dendrinos. And he's going to call his second timeout of the half and design another play. A good bit of coaching by Mekos Dendrinos. He is working with a, I wouldn't say not talented, but maybe inexperienced, or his bench is not really that deep.
Resubstitution, number 15, Wallace.
Working down court with 4 seconds to go. Chris Kadulu for two. It's long. Basulis with the rebound, and he has it knocked away. Total of 6 points. Nice cut across the lane. Great interior passing, and it finishes with a slam dunk by Stojan Brankovic. So they are one of their last 11 field goal attempts. Kukoc throws up a poor shot. Not sure what he was thinking. Yanakis. Greece moving it well. Bakatsias inside. Maybe one pass too many. Yanakis. A little bit long. Rebound Croatia. Brankovic. Nice strong move. Off glass and the basket counts.
Basket is good.
And maybe more disturbing for Greece. That is the fourth foul on Christodoulou. Christodoulou still covering Raja. A short jump stop and a jumper is off the mark. And inside, up and good. Yanakis looking for somewhere to go. Christodoulou with an isolation. Still struggling. He is distraught. And he's getting down on himself. He's talking to himself. He's trying to figure out why he is unable to connect on his jump shots today. He's just 1 of 10 for a total of 2 points. And he has 4 fouls. And he must be careful Russell get his fifth and a three-point shot from outside by Arian Kamazic. A dejected Fasulis watching from the sidelines. The lead 51-36 with 13 minutes to play in the game. A bronze medal at stake for both these teams. And Greece starting to see that bronze slip away into the Croatian hands. Giannakis, Christodoulou, will he finally connect? Yes, he does. Down in the low post, and they do it again, predictably so. They have the good inside-outside, and that's the outside part of that equation. Kamazic hitting his second consecutive three. Makatsias wheeling and dealing, kicking it out to Christodoulou. Straight butter, baby. Eight on the shot clock. Baseline drive. Kamazic looking for the shot. Spike it, Cannon hits nothing but string music. For Greece, Christodoulou barely missing. Takes another crack and got it to fall.
Number 15, Panis.
Sigalis providing tough defense. Greece almost coming up with the steal. Kamazic. Missing it and a dunk by Stojan Brankovic. He flushed it home. Oh my. A drive into the paint, Fasulis with the block. Sigalis. The spin and the bank is open. Giannakis back in the game. Pulls up from 15, it goes 14. And a foul called against the veteran 35-year-old.
Greece foul, charge to number 6 by the Jonas Giannakis. First personal foul.
Here's another look at the foul. Oh yes, he chopped him on the arm. And a little bit of Broadway acting. They have a tremendous future, Greece does. Brenzias, a young center, and many other young, talented players in the stable. That dunk will not count, but the final score from Sky Dome in Toronto, Croatia 78, Greece 60. And Croatia takes home a bronze medal from these World Championships of Basketball.
The 1994 World Championship of Basketball. The medal will be presented at the conclusion of...
Inside, under the concrete roof, the retractable roof of Sky Dome. This is the gold medal game of the 1994 World Championships of Basketball between the United States, aka Dream Team 2, and the Russians. A matchup that always conjures up images of the quintessence of competition. This is the gold medal game. The United States 7-0 overall in the tournament. They are undefeated, defeated Russia 111-94 in the quarterfinal matchup game. Russia just one loss overall, and that loss coming at the hands of the Americans. Dream Team 2 about to write their own legacy here this afternoon. How will they be remembered? That is the question. The United States, of course, the gold medal winners at the 1992 Olympics, and there's one of the stars so far, the Americans, Reggie Miller. Miller has averaged 18 points a game on 51% three-point shooting. He's 28 years old. He's a member of the Indiana Pacers, and he comes from a long line of athletic talent as well. Reggie Miller, one of the best pure shooters in the entire world. And the other part of that 1-2 punch, Shaquille O'Neal, the man-child, also averaging 18 points a game to go with 8.2 rebounds on 76% shooting from the field. He is taking high percentage shots, most of them coming in the form of dunks. He's just 22 years old, folks. The best years for Shaquille O'Neal are still ahead. Isn't that a frightening thought? O'Neal was born in Newark, New Jersey, and he is currently a member of the Orlando Magic in the NBA. And there's a look at the Russian team, the 1988 gold medalists in the Olympics. A talented crew. They are coming off an upset yesterday of the Croatian team. Russia winning that game 66-64, and there's the leading scorer, Sergei Bazarevich, averaging 16.1 points a game to go with 4.4 rebounds. He's 29 years old, And he is a very talented point guard, folks. He has very good quickness. The man taking pictures with the camera should be in uniform. That is Andrei Fetisov. He sprained his ankle yesterday in the matchup against Croatia. He landed on Dino Raja's foot, twisted his ankle, and did not return to the game. And with him on the bench, he will be taking his 10 points per outing. The head coach, Sergei Belov, voted at one point the best player in Europe. As we await the opening tip-off, just a few minutes away in these 1994 World Championships of Basketball. So we'll see just how much the Russians miss Andrei Fetisov. Last game between these two teams, it was very close at halftime. Keep that in mind. It was not a jog for the Americans by any stretch. And while the Americans remain the strong, overwhelming favorites, anything can happen, so that's why we play these games. Coleman on the wing. Miller posts up and then moves out. A skip pass. Richard Miller has been deadly from three-point range and passes it up. Coleman instead takes the three and hits the first shot of the game for the Americans. Derek Coleman shows you why he is regarded as one of the best power forwards in the world. He's strong inside and has a soft touch outside. Bazarevich. And the Americans, interestingly enough, put their best defender on Bazarevich, Joe Dumars. And he shows you why he was voted on the All-NBA defensive team. Joe Dumars with the steal. Coleman inside, hacked in the act and won. Defensively, they have turned up the pressure meter as well. Coleman defending, missed and then converted by Mikhail Mikhailov. Coleman, a lot of contact, didn't bother him though. The bank is open, even on Sunday. Derek Coleman, Johnson tries to dish it off to him, and Bazarevich is dangerous in the open court, and that's exactly what I mean. He is fearless, taking the ball for the steal. And Bazarevich gets his first field goal. And the lead is 15 to the 8. Kemp inside, elevating and laying it in softly with the left hand. Nice ball fake that time. Rucha couldn't get it to fall. Dumars for three. Bingo!
Hello, the period.
Look at the tenacity of Derek Coleman on the boards. Get the outlet pass, put it in the middle where the ball should be. And Joe Dumars says, I think I'll take it myself. It's a revit. Oh, a nice bit of ball handling, but he forgot to finish the layup. Coleman. Oh, baby! And you get the feeling that they were just waiting for an opportunity to turn it on. John Kemp blocks it. A nice follow, but Mikhailov couldn't get it to fall. And another block inside. And Sergei Belov, the head coach for Russia, is infuriated that there wasn't a foul called. Let's take another look at the replay and see if there should have been one called. Belov is livid. He is livid. Interestingly enough, Babcock did not start for the Russians. Kemp inside, slam it home. Nobody does the voodoo like you do, Sean Kemp. That's why they call him the Rain Man. 38-16 with 12:15 to play in the first half, and another steal by the Americans. Here's Damani. Cross court to Kasarov. They're looking for a bit of offensive flow here. They're not too fluid in the half court. And a tripping foul against Sean Kemp on Babcock.
USA foul, the fifth team foul of the period. Number seven,
Sean Kemp. In America, they call it hops. In America, they call it ups. What it simply means, folks, is that he can jump. Here's Damani. Nice pull-up jump shot off the dribble. Missed the jump shot. And a quick out court outlet, and Coleman with the tomahawk.
Coleman from Kevin Johnson.
Who wants to shoot it, they say. Kemp wheeling inside. Up strong, and Sean Kemp is just too much inside for the Russians so far. That might be a call for help for the Russians. I'm not sure who that man is speaking to. Might want to think about bringing in some troops. O'Neal, nice pass inside to Kemp, who slams it in the face of Nassar. Inside to Nassar. Russians move it around nicely, and Damani hits the three-point shot.
Dimitri
Damani came strong. So the Americans aren't the only guys that can dunk. Excuse me, Shaquille O'Neal. 14 seconds to go. The Russians will hold the ball and take one. Play for a last shot, 73-38. And for those people that thought the Russians actually might give them a game, I guess they were wrong. Babcock stops and pops and drops.
Number 10,
nice shot by Babcock. But the Russians
40,
still trail 73-40 at halftime. As we get set for the start of the second half in this gold medal game at Skydome. United States leading Russia 73-40. USA controls the tip. Starting for the USA, Dumars, Kemp, Johnson, Warning, and Reggie Miller. Those are the five on the floor. There's three up in the air, and it's good. Joe Dumars hits for three. Azarevic, so quick to the basket. And that's why people say that he has the talent to be in the NBA. Sean Kemp is in the NBA, and he's in the house. Sean Kemp. Thought about the three, goes inside to Kemp. Warning down the pipe.
Number 14,
Americans getting out of the gate fast in the second half here. There's the dunk by Sean Kemp. And the post back at basket celebration. And here's Warning. Bazarevic. Nice basket by Sergei Bazarevic. Dominique Wilkins had an isolation on the wing but passed it up. Warning. That's a big time hook shot.
14, Alonzo. Warning.
Bazarevic. Nice pass. Bazarevic has great court vision. Here come the Americans. They have a 3-on-2 advantage. Johnson misses it. He left it up there and it fell on. Kasachev. Oh! And a nice attempt by Nassar. He may have hurt himself. Johnson misses. This game is very sloppy right now. Course of the game. It's 104-65. O'Neal for three. Oh my goodness. Not used to seeing him take three-point shots. Price has it knocked away. Wilkins will take a three-pointer. This is where Shaq belongs. And that's what he does best.
That's what he's good.
Damani with the dunk. Money with 11 points.
The basket to Sergei Bazarevic.
Bazarevic will be credited with that basket. Here's Steve Smith. Steve Smith has received the fewest amount of minutes among the Americans. Shaquille O'Neal.
Shaquille O'Neal.
Americans leading by 44 points. Give and go basketball. Good, solid, fundamental basketball. Bazarevic finishes it with the layup. Marley for three. So even when the Russians score a good basket, score two, the Americans come back and increase the margin by hitting the three.
Number 10, Sergei.
And Babcock
responds with a three of his own. Babcock now has 17 points. Larry Johnson, everybody joining in this three-point orgy. It is 130 to 85. Less than 2 minutes to play. A nice pull-up jump shot by Mikhail Mikhailov. Mikhailov has had a nice afternoon. He scored 17 points. Steve Smith for three. Dominique Wilkins again. A little bit of showtime now for the Americans. Wilkins with 18 points. The United States scored a record 134 points in the game earlier in this tournament. And they could very well break that mark here. Bazarevich mismatched on Larry Johnson. Babcock, yes, the bank is open. Banks at home. The next basket will tie their largest total. And a three-pointer on its way, it's off. Bazarevich misses. And we are in the dying seconds of the gold medal game. The Americans leading it 132 to 89. It has been a picture of dominance. And that three-pointer sets a new record for most points scored in the game by the United States. 135. And the gold medal goes to the United States of America. And Shaquille O'Neal and his troops win the final score 135 to 91. They take home the gold.
Congratulations to the USA on achieving the gold medal.
So the United States reclaims the gold medal that they lost in 1990. It was an inspiring performance by not only Dan Marley, but the rest of the team. Derek Coleman came out early and set the tone. All this witnessed by a FIBA record 32,660 people in attendance. The total for the tournament was 332,354. That also a FIBA record. So, all in all, this tournament a major success for international basketball.
They can't come true.
And so the journey to the top of the dais was complete for Dream Team 2. Nothing less would have been acceptable for a team blessed with such talent and ability. And yet, they still had to deal with the enormous responsibility of following in the footsteps of the much-vaunted Dream Team 1. This, as much as anything, was their outstanding achievement. They did all that was asked of them, and with youthful flair and exuberance, they now pass the torch.
Do you hear what I'm saying? Gotta say how I feel. I can't believe it, but I know that you're real. I know what I want, and baby, it's you. Standing on my feelings because they are true, yeah. Dreams can come true. Look at me, babe, I'm with you. You know you got to have hope. You know you got to be strong. They are true, yeah.
Yeah.